And welcome to From This Corner TV. We are not in the studio today. We are doing remote here in Guilford, Connecticut. I'm Marilyn Dayton, your host and producer, and Dodie Milardo is with us as co-host again. We're very, very proud today to be introducing to you a group of wonderful, very special young students. They go, obviously, here at Guilford High School, and they have formed a film club, and they have done amazing things. They've made several short films, even the freshman orientation film. But what we're going to be talking about today is their movie called One, O-N-E, One. And it's amazing. And before we talk to them, though,
today we are going to be meeting the principal of the school, Mr. Rick Macenti, and we are going to meet the Dean of Students, Donna Putlinski.
Well, I can't wait to meet them, and I can't wait to meet these students. So let's head on inside and talk.
Okay. We are here today with Rick Macenti. Mr. Macenti, he's told me he is the luckiest principal in the whole state of Connecticut. So, you must be really proud of these fabulous kids who've created this movie.
Oh, very much so. You know, their creativity, their work with technology, their passion for making this happen really mirrors a lot of what our student body is all about as well. So we're real proud of the way they've represented our school, our community, and the teaching staff here.
Great. Thank you. Hello again. We are here now with Donna Putlinski. Donna is a Dean of Students here at Guilford High School. And Donna, I'd like to know, how did this all come about? How did it happen?
Basically, you start with some students who have a passion for something. You bring in a teacher who understands and is willing to foster that passion.
And this, that would be?
That would be Mr. Ripa.
Mr. Ripa. Gotta give him a plug.
Absolutely. It well deserves it.
Good.
This is a film club. This isn't even necessarily a class, but I think the students' passion sort of came out of some work that they did in class with Mr. Ripa when they were younger students. Mm-hmm. They had a desire to make a movie, and we let them go. And then they came to us, you know, can we show this movie now that we've made it? Because they had a baby they wanted to show off. And we're like, sure, we have a brand new performing arts center. We can give you a wonderful venue. And they basically packed the house. It was amazing.
Yes, I was there. 450 people.
Standing ovations, yeah. And well-deserved.
Yes, absolutely. Did they have equipment? How did they get equipment for this?
So their equipment is school equipment that they borrowed from Mr. Ripa and from the school and worked on their own. They did a lot of this over the summer. So we're talking about, you know, somebody who really has a desire to do something. If they're willing to give up hours, days, weeks of their summer in order to make this happen.
In the heat.
In Guilford, yes.
Yeah. That's right. You have a photography class here, and I think that maybe...
We have TV production classes. We're now up to two of them, and then some of the students are going back and doing lab assistants with Mr. Ripa so they can continue to work in the class, or independent studies.
Fabulous.
So there are two classes to begin, and then they just keep going.
Fabulous. Well, thank you for being with us today. We are here at the library in the brand new Guilford High School. And you can see it's full of light and glass and wonderful people here today. We are here with the film club, the Guilford High School Film Club. And these are some of the students that were involved in creating this movie called One. I'm going to go around and ask each of you, if you would, to say your name and the part you played and maybe a little bit about the part, okay?
I'm Francesco Giordano. I played Declan Smith in the movie. He's the representative for the O.N.E. Corporation, which is like the matchmaking basis in the story. And when there's problems later in the plot with the between the two characters, I play as kind of a relationship counselor of sorts.
I'm Kendra Fiala. I played Madison Davenport. She was one of the main characters, and she could be described as very much of a daydreamer. And you can see later on in the film how sometimes that might not work to her advantage.
My name is George Wang. I played Aiden Lee, who was the best friend of Connor Wilson, which is Blake. And he was basically just there to consult with Connor in the early stages of his relationship to get him rolling with the physical process of it. And then later he comes back and he interacts with Connor some more. So, yeah.
I'm Blake Donovan, and like George said, I played Connor, who's one of the other main characters. And Connor, he has good intentions, but things don't usually tend to work out his way, and that's where most of the problems in his life come from.
I'm Hank Hunke. I was one of the main cinematographers on set for One, and I specialize in the use for the glide cam.
Okay. Blake, can you share with us why you made the movie?
Yeah, so at the end of our junior year, we had made our longest film at the time, which was called Bands of Fury, and it was about 10 minutes long. And that was the first time we really got involved into writing a full script and developing a story and developing the characters themselves. So it was actually at the little premiere party that we hosted for ourselves for that film that George came up to me and was like, hey, I want to make a full-length film. I was like, well, if you write it, then okay. So, and he did. So that kind of just, and we all just, we put together a crew, and it just took off from there.
Okay.
George, I'm going to ask George. Yeah. Now, for the audience's benefit, George was the writer, editor, director, and actor. He had kind of a full plate here. So what I want to know is, where did the idea come from? Where did the storyline come from for the movie?
Yeah, so as Blake said, we wanted to do a full-length movie, so I kind of headed to like brainstorming about, you know, concepts that would make an interesting plot. And I guess from my background, with especially a Chinese background, where in the past, you know, marriages were kind of arranged in a more like traditional setup. So I kind of wanted to explore that theme more and kind of apply it to contemporary society. And also just multiple YouTube videos and chick flicks that I watched kind of inspired me to do sort of a love story. And also I was really interested in kind of a sci-fi theme and being able to incorporate that as well as the love aspect and the historical aspect was actually really inspiring to me. So, yeah.
How long did it take you to write the script?
It took a total of about 2 to 3 weeks. It was a 44-page script, and it wasn't that hard. Once I got rolling in the first few scenes, it kind of just, you know, fell together then because I was able to develop the characters, and I kind of knew what the characters wanted to do. So that was kind of, it got easier as I went along.
So was there room for flexibility in the script? Like if somebody said, I should really say this here, did you welcome that?
Yeah, I mean, certainly when we did filming, especially all of our cast actually had their own opinions on how to say a certain thing or how to, you know, act this way. And it was totally fine because I wanted to give them the full control over their characters and what they wanted to take their characters in the direction of. And so even though I scripted out a lot of dialogue, it ended up not being used because obviously Blake, Kendra, and many of the other actors wanted to phrase it differently that would make more sense in their character.
Now, Blake, you were not only playing the lead, but you also were a producer.
Right.
So what did that involve?
So it involved a lot of hours with George doing... we did a little bit of script editing, but he mostly handled all that, and he did really well on that. So once that was all taken care of, now it came down to scheduling, which was incredibly difficult because we had, like, 18 people. So, and it's summertime, so people are busy. So it was scheduling, and then it was creating lists for equipment that we were going to be needing, props lists that we were going to be needing, coordinating with all of the actors and crew and making sure everybody, all the actors had the right costumes that they needed, and just kind of keeping everything on track so everything can happen.
Now, did you stage tryouts, or how did you handle that part?
So for casting, we mostly went with people we knew or people that we knew that they knew. So for Kendra, she had been in Bands of Fury, which was a film prior to One, and we liked how she played that role and how excited she was to be in the film. And so we really wanted to ask her back to play a leading role for Madison. And really the biggest roles came from how available those actors were, because we needed the commitment and we needed the actors to be there for every single day that we needed them, or else this whole project wasn't going to work.
And Hank, I wanted to ask you a question. You're a cinematographer, but you had, didn't you have kind of a special camera that you used?
So, going into the project, we had done a lot of kind of standard, when you're not so high up on the chain, like when you haven't been making movies for a while, you tend to do like a lot of standstill shots, a lot of tripod shots. And I had gotten into, before the whole movie scene, kind of glide cam, steady cam work, which is moving camera. And so when I was brought into the film, one of the main reasons was because I was able to not only operate, but I was able to operate to like the fullest potential. And it takes what I use was a glide cam, and it took a pretty big learning curve behind it. So it's not something that you can just pick up and kind of learn. It took me, I took like watched a lot of YouTube videos. I had to do a lot behind that to get it to where the point I was ready to do stuff in the movie with them. And that was like the tool I used. That's what I contributed to the movie.
That was your own equipment you had?
Yeah.
Oh, cool. And so what kind of equipment did the school have for you? And were there things that you didn't have that you had to figure out how, your way around those?
Yes, so we borrowed a lot of equipment from the school. So the cameras came from the school. Mm-hmm. We had a 3-camera setup at our largest and a 1-camera setup at our smallest. Mm-hmm. And the tripods came from the school. The sound equipment that we had was not quite up to par. So sound was difficult, and for some scenes we had to either redo the scene entirely or we had to take new sound for it. But, so yeah, if we did have wireless microphones or like a boom, that would have increased the value of our production, but we tried hard to make it work with what we had.
We're also very lucky to have a film teacher so dedicated helping us what we do, Mr. Ripa. Mm-hmm. He really pushes the departments to get stuff that helps us with our movie making.
So. Cool. Yeah, we wanted him on with us today, but he couldn't make it. So we have to give him a good plug.
Well, I'm going to move the questions along in a little bit different direction, because Blake, you already mentioned that you filmed over the summertime.
Right. Yes.
And I was going to ask you that later on, but I'm going to talk about it now. So what were some of the challenges that you ran into being summer, other than everybody's schedule, and where did you film, and how long did you film for?
So, a huge struggle for it being the summer was the heat itself. The final scene was actually not supposed to be where we shot it that made it into the final film, but it was actually supposed to be at the beach. And it was supposed to include an ice cream cone, where George was supposed to bring in an ice cream cone. And so we tried our best with the ice cream to put it in a cooler and keep it cold, but by the time George came over with the ice cream cone, it was soup. So, and that, adding to the wind at the beach, it made the whole kind of scenario it wouldn't function for what we needed to be. And so the heat was a big thing. especially when we're working long days. We worked 12-hour days at times, and so we would have to stay hydrated and like get food along the way and like make sure that we're like in the game and like ready and focused. But we filmed at a lot of places. We filmed at Guilford Point, right? Mm-hmm. We filmed at the Madison Green, the Guilford Green, at many people's houses, and a bunch of different places that really were local to the area.
I want to know whose house, whose kitchen you trashed.
That was my kitchen. Yeah.
I felt so bad about that. I was like, I'm sorry, I made a mess in your house.
Looking back, the flour was not a good idea.
Yeah, I don't know. I talked to your mom about that, and she seems to have taken that very well.
She did.
I love my mom. She's easy to get out of things. But on my part, the flour was not a good idea. But it worked, so.
Should we explain
it
this
looked
scene?
Like fun.
They were having... I don't want to give the movie away or anything, but they were having a fight in the kitchen. A teasing fight. A fun fight. And they were throwing flour at each other. And the place was a mess at the end. It was just...
And of course, you know, I'm watching this amazing movie that these kids made, okay? And I'm trying to remember that they're very young people and just learning filmmaking. But you can't help it, but you get into the movie and you're watching them throwing this flour all over and you're going, oh my God, that looks like fun. And then it hits you.
Who's going to clean it up?
It's almost like when you make a movie, you can't forget you need a cleanup committee.
That's very true.
Well, who did clean it up?
We did.
Oh. We did.
Okay.
Well, I have to say that it was extremely enjoyable to watch it. You were so proper. Is he that way normally? You know, but you're not. He's not. That's called acting.
Okay.
And what I want to do in the second half of the show is I want to get more into what you learned and how maybe it's changing your future and the way you're looking at your future. But what I want to do is I would like to go to, before the break, I would like to run a film demo sample so that you can see some of what these creative young people have created. And then we'll have a break. And then when we come back, before you see us again, you are going to see a trailer from this movie. And we'll see if we have time to run two trailers. We'll see how that works. But you're going to get interested in it, and we're also going to tell you where you can go to look at it, okay? So what we're going to do right now is we're going to cut to that demo sample, and then we'll be back after the trailer.
And can I just add that
they
made the trailer also.
They made everything.
They made all of it. They're very talented, very, very capable and talented.
So we'll be back, and we'll see you on the other side.
Falling off the door, hanging off the hinges. My feet are still sore, my back's on the fringes. We tore up the walls, we slept on couches. We lifted this house, we lifted this house. Firecrackers in the east, my car parks out. Your hands on my cheeks, your shoulder in my mouth. I was up against the wall on the west mezzanine. We rattle this town, we rattle this scene. We're doing all this, house is falling apart. fumbling round the back, not one seatbelt on. Wait for summertime, coming up for air. Now it's all a wash, now it's all a wash. Live my life without coming up for air. Now it's all a wash, I want everyone. Racing down the hill, I am faster than.
You always made sure I brushed my teeth.
You told me that smart was cool.
You always told me to dream big.
To all of those parents who took the time to make raising their children their most important job, we'd like to say
thank you.
Thank you.
From the bottom of my heart, thanks, Mom and Dad.
This message is brought to you by the U.S. Air Force.
If you keep tanning, indoors or out, the effects of harmful rays will show up on your skin. Wrinkles, age spots, and an increased risk of melanoma, the second most common cancer in women 15 to 29. Stop tanning. Time may not be on your side. Learn how to protect your skin at spotskincancer.org. A message from the American Academy of Dermatology.
You'd do anything to take care of that spot on your lawn. So why not take care of that spot on your skin? If you're a man over 50, you're in the group most likely to develop skin cancer, including melanoma, the cancer that kills one person every hour. Check your skin for suspicious or changing spots. Go to spotskincancer.org to find out what to look for. A message from the American Academy of Dermatology.
Oh, hey, bud. Where are you headed?
I'm just gonna hang out.
With Gary and Todd?
Yeah.
I've been meaning to ask you, is there any drinking going on in this crowd?
No.
If any of your buddies ever pressure you to take a drink, just tell them you promised your dad you wouldn't. I'd do anything to keep you safe.
Okay, I will.
I hope this is working.
I promise. Love you too, Dad.
They really do hear you. For tips on what to say, visit underagedrinking.samhsa.gov.
You have to know yourself and know what makes you happy, Madison. I know that society looks down on these terminations, but this decision is based solely on your happiness. You have to do what's best for you.
Madison, I love you.
I love you too. Like, it's just like when I'm with you, I feel like I'm home. And I haven't felt that way in a while.
We'll be right back.
Welcome back to From This Corner TV. Once again, we are at the Guilford High School here in Connecticut, and we have this group of very, very talented, creative young people who formed a film club and started making movies. Now, before you saw us again, you saw two trailers of the movie One, and we're going to explain a little bit more on what that one stands for, even though you did touch on it. You also saw their film demo sample with some of the films that they've done.
The techniques that they've created, filming techniques and things, yeah.
And you also saw The Return of the Dorito. And I know you had to have enjoyed that. So what we're going to do is we're going to talk more with each person. But first of all, I want you to take note, write down their names, okay? Because these young people, you're going to be reading about them in the future, okay? And number two, I want you to write down their YouTube channel, which we're going to be showing you at the bottom of the screen. And that is Just Roll With It Productions. And you can go to that YouTube channel and you can see the full movie. And you can also see Return of the Doritos all over again because it's fun. And Dodie.
Well, I thought what we would do is go around the room and for each of you, if you would talk about what you've learned from going through this experience and is there a future in it for you, okay?
Sure. Awesome.
Good.
So I've always known that I was interested in film. Lots of people that I'm surrounded with, my family and friends, work in this field, and I've just always enjoyed watching films.
Oh, what do they do?
I have a friend who's a storyboard artist, actually, and he does the drawings and kind of lays out the scenes before they film movies.
Uh-huh.
In junior year, actually, I did a capstone project, which is just like an independent study that you can do outside of school. And so I did that, and I did a series of interviews with him, and I really got to talk with him and learn a lot about that, mm-hmm. that field. And it was fascinating. So when I got a call from Blake over here over the summer to come and play Declan, he sent me the script, and I was immediately very interested. And I came down and I played those scenes, and then I got to film a little bit as well. Mm-hmm. And that kind of opened the doors for me to get more involved in this club. And since then, I've filmed other things as well. It's been great.
Yeah. Good. And do you think this is your future?
I just got into Fairfield University. I'm hoping to go into their film program.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
Similar to Chesco, I've always been interested in acting, but I never really thought anything of it. It's always just been kind of in the back of my mind. And so when I was asked to be in Bands of Fury, that really kind of got the ball rolling for me. And I just kept on wanting to just do more and act more. So as soon as they asked me to be in this, I was beyond belief, like just so excited about it. And it really taught me that if you have a dream, even if you think it's silly, it can happen for you. And this has been a very good experience.
Good.
All right, so my interest in film actually started back in freshman year when I took a TV production class, and that's where I met Blake in the same class. And after a year of taking the same class together, we decided we wanted to do more with film and bring some of the people together that we were originally with in TV production. So that's how Film Club kind of started. And from there, I guess we just started to actually get more involved in making short films and anything we could do, even help the school with musicals and plays, just to get more involved in film and seeing how that interest would take us. And so being able to do this movie truly kind of was a goal or a dream of ours before leaving high school. I mean, not many high school students get to leave high school saying that they created an hour film. So I'm not exactly sure what I want to do in my life. There's a few majors that I want to consider in, but film has been and always will be a sort of creative outlet for me, whether I choose to pursue it in the future or not. I think it's a great opportunity for someone to express themselves, to dig deep into their emotions and find something that speaks to them, and then write stories about it, and then share it with other people and spread good messages to other people. So I think film has the ability to touch a lot of people's hearts, as well as just, you know, it's just a fun thing to do in general.
I grew up as a little kid, like, sitting in front of the TV watching Disney Channel, and I'd be like, wow, that has to be, like, so cool if I could just be on TV and, like, be acting on these crazy sets. But I never really thought anything more about it. I never tried out for any plays or anything like that growing up. And then freshman year, me and George got into filming, and yeah, I acted in some of those films, but I was still more into the directing and stuff like that. And then junior year, I started getting into the acting part, and then when George allowed me to play Connor, I was super excited because that was the first opportunity I had to really develop a character, because all of our other films were short and there was no time for character development. But with this hour and this 44-page script, I could really dig into the character and really, like, work with him. And so that was probably the best part of this experience, was being able to dig deeper into the craft of acting.
So I started kind of filmmaking. I've never really been into acting. I haven't really tried it either, so I can't say much.
You like the other side of the camera.
Yeah, other side of the camera. But I really started in about fifth or sixth grade. A friend and I, we started making claymations for school projects because it was an outlet that we hated doing PowerPoints, we hated doing writing essays, and presenting was always kind of difficult at that age. So we started making claymations. His father's actually a sculptor, works for the Guilford, New Haven Peabody Museum. So we always had access to clay. We make these, like, little videos. And that's where it started to peak. And then I created a small YouTube channel. We put up kind of stupid skits and just, like, try to do review videos on it. It was a boatload of fun. And it kind of dropped off a little bit. And I think around at the very end of eighth grade, I got my first camera, and it was a GoPro. I just went everywhere with it. I did everything with it. And I was having a lot of fun with it. And then going to sophomore year, I realized, hey, I want to take a TV production class. And that's kind of where I met Mr. Reba, and then who connected me to Blake. And we formed a kind of relationship through that. And then I was offered to help work in the films. And I liked that a lot. And of course, I further progressed. I got myself the glide cam that I talked about before. And I just started making kind of my own movies. Personally, I'm not really into fictional movies. I love watching them, but I really like documentary-type filmmaking, and that's something that I'm kind of invested in. I'm planning on minoring in that in college. It's an interest, and I'm actually working for a capstone project, like Francesco said. I'm doing a film, a documentary-style film on parkour and free running, on kind of how it's a sport and how it's been progressing over the years. So that's my interest.
How does this camera work?
Yeah, can you describe this glide cam?
It's a camera system. You can use it with whatever kind of, like, camera you want. But pretty much it's a three-axis gimbal. So it works up and down, side to side, and it rotates. And it's meant to absorb shock. And so there's weights on the bottom. There's a center column with kind of a handle sticking off of it. I wish I'd brought it in. It'd be much easier to show. It's a handle sticking off, and there's, like, this plate on the top where you mount your camera. And basically it's very sensitive, but you have to balance out the camera. So when you hold the handle, it just stays steady. And then from then on, you kind of have to, like, get into, like, a form to use it. And, like, it takes a lot of concentration, but the gimbal helps take away all the movement, so it keeps the camera in place. And that's how you get these really steady shots. I have one that's handheld, but on the bigger sets of Hollywood, they have ones that, and actually we had a film student come in and show us his, but it's, like, it has an arm and it comes down to, like, a body rig, so you can sprint with it on, and it's it's very fluid, and it really provides a whole new type of angle for a lot of movies.
Wow, progress. It's amazing what you can do. Yeah. I'm going to back up a second. I've got a question. Now, you mentioned the film club. Was there a film club before you...
No. So we kind of, we would have joined the film club if there was one, but seeing that there was a lack of it, we thought it was time that maybe we should start a film club in GHS, seeing that many students were obviously very interested in film, but we never really had an organization at this school where we would gather all these people together with a similar interest and create movies and explore other techniques.
Was it hard to convince the school to allow you to do this?
I would say no, because the administration was very, very lenient on helping us, and they even made sure that we had what we needed, the knowledge that we needed to start a club, and all we had to do was fill out some paperwork and then get an advisor, Mr. Ripa, to kind of guide us through this process. And then once that happened, they were pretty much laid back. They didn't really put more than was required attention on the club, and really let us do what we wanted to do and take it in the direction we wanted to take it into.
Did they help you with the filming while you were filming in the summer? Or you just were taking that all on yourselves?
I mean, they didn't have any physical contributions to the film, and we didn't ask for it, to be fair. We wanted to figure out things for our own, and cool. They understood that, but they were always happy to provide us with the equipment we needed mm-hmm. throughout the summer, and without any kind of really hard, you know, conditions to hold up, we were able to get the equipment pretty easily from our TV production teacher, and also they allowed us the facility at the school to film whatever you want to do, and they also helped us when we wanted to show a premiere at the school. They set up the auditorium and helped us kind of bring the film to the student body.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Now, I understand that premiere, you had a full house.
Oh yeah.
We pretty close. Yeah, we had an estimated about 450 people show yep. up, which we were very excited about.
Yep.
And these were all family, friends,
school. Yeah, yep. So anyone from the community. We had a lot of students, but also we did a lot of advertising around Guilford and around Madison, and that brought out a lot of other people that didn't even really have a relation to the school or anyone in the school. So it was really cool because we reached out to a lot of different age groups and demographics, and they all came together, and it was a really cool night.
Well, you also got great coverage in the Guilford Courier, the New Haven Register, and Shoreline Times, mm-hmm. right? Yeah. So they did a lot of their own. I don't know how you get that kind of coverage. You guys did a really good. That's not easy.
Do you know how hard it is to hold an event? I know. I've tried several times and get people to come out and attend it. It's not easy. When I heard that you had so many people at your premiere, I went, wow. You know, these kids have multiple talents.
Yeah. And they made the posters, and mm-hmm. they put the posters up around town. And did you have them with the little thing you break off in? With
no,
a
we didn't.
No, you didn't do that. Mm.
That would be a good idea, though.
Next time.
For the time and day or whatever, you know. But I mean, how creative. They did their own trailers. They did their own posters. They got the articles in the paper, and 450 people. You can't beat 450 people coming to a...
You really can't.
Unbelievable.
Now, I heard somebody just say next time. Okay, that brings me to a question that we were talking
yes.
about. We were going to ask you. Okay, the first one is called One. Is there a sequel?
Joke.
A lot of people have made jokes about the sequel called Two. And it's a well-known joke around the school. Mm-hmm. Whenever people, you know, kind of see us or talk to us, they kind of mention that.
Yeah.
But sequel-wise, it all depends on, I guess, availability. Obviously, we're going off to college next year, most of us, with the exception of Kendra.
And Hank,
because they're juniors. So being able to gather people and the same resources would be kind of hard.
Mm.
But I certainly do see a sort of cooperation, whether it be the sequel or not, just within this group. And whenever we get together, I'm sure we're going to make more films and more shorts or whatever we decide on doing.
Right. There's definitely a potential for something else to happen. It just, all the pieces have to line up. Mm-hmm. So if they do, then we would all be very excited to do another film.
Well, what I also wanted to know was, when we were thinking about the sequel called 2, it made me think, now this is about matchmaking, correct?
Yeah.
Why was it called 1 and not 2?
Oh, you got to tell them what 1 stands for.
Yeah, so 1 is actually an acronym for Ominous and Network of Emotions, which is a very, very esoteric way of saying it's a branch of government or a corporation that kind of pairs people together based on similar interests, intelligence and likes and dislikes. So with one, we also wanted to also touch upon the fact that when they do get matched up, you matched up with basically the one person that you would be with for the rest of your life. And those two people come together kind of make kind of one person, if that makes any sense. But it's trying to show that the relationships that are created are kind of everlasting in that way, and you only need one throughout your whole life.
I love it.
Yeah.
I love it.
Yeah.
And I am just very, very grateful that we could sit down and talk about this before school ends, because they're all going to be going in different directions.
Yep.
Did you have something?
Yeah. Blake, you want to share with us the experience you recently had as an intern?
Yeah, so recently Francesco and I were...
Oh, I'm sorry, both of you.
Oh, wow.
We were...
That's right, both of them.
We were asked to be interns on a short film that was filmed locally in Guilford, and so we were production assistants, and basically we just ran and got equipment and food and stuff like that. But it was awesome to be in that setting and to be learning from these people that have been doing these things for years. And I learned a lot just from being around them and listening to them and watching how they worked, and it was really an awesome experience.
Yeah, getting those professional experiences, mm-hmm. you know, and they've done lots of other projects that are professional quality, and making connections and learning new things that I never would have guessed happened behind the scenes mm-hmm. was really an eye-opening experience, and it also gave me a peek into possible future plans. Yeah.
Good.
Yeah, yeah.
Good.
Do you know how that came about? How did that happen?
So a friend of mine, her mom was the producer for the short film, and so she knew I was interested in film, and then she asked if I knew anybody else, and I asked Jesco because I knew he was interested in pursuing film as a future career.
And the interesting thing is, as we sit here and we're listening to them talking about being a part of that film, I'm sitting across from one of the associate producers of that particular film, and she didn't even know about that.
I opened a newsletter that I never opened. It's usually I just delete it. But this, for some reason, I opened it that day, and the gentleman who wrote the movie, there was an article about how he was coming back to do this movie in town, 1.6 miles from where I live. And I thought, well, I don't think I'm ever going to get any closer than that to a film. And I decided to support the effort, and I got to spend some time on the set. Things that you just don't have any idea, you don't think about when a movie is being made. The guy next door decided to start up his chainsaw right in the middle of a scene. And they have to stop everything. That's not the sound they want in the film. But it was fascinating, and the weather, the temperature was—it was very cold.
Yeah, they made it look an entirely different season.
Yeah. Impressive. Yep. Mm-hmm.
Yes, because one of the parts of acting is you can be in the Arctic, and you have to wear different clothes than you normally would, and you're standing there shivering. You can't show it.
Right.
That's really
right. Right, and the lead had to do that. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, a lot of things are happening in Guilford, Connecticut. Yep. And I'm so very happy, once again, that you were able to join us.
Yes, thank you.
And congratulations on doing such a great job with not just one, but the other films that you've done.
Thank you. Thank you for having us.
Thank you.
Well, it's our pleasure. totally and completely. What I like to do at the end of every show is I like to do a notable quote, and one that relates to what we've been talking to. And I'm going to quote the late actor Philip Seymour Hoffman, who actually was born and raised in a town in upstate New York, right one town over from where I spent 26 years raising my family. So he always kind of held a special place in our heart. He said, and he was a wonderful actor, excellent actor, he said, study, find all the right teachers, study with them, get involved with acting and writing, not for the money, but for the love of doing it. Thank you for joining us, and we'll see you next time on From This Corner TV.
So you guys know I'm a kid from school, right? So I was walking in the hallway the other day, minding my own business, and apparently he was around the corner waiting for me. And the first thing he did was he sucker punched me, like, right in the stomach.
What?
You know, at first I thought it was a prank, but after the, a couple more punches, I realized it wasn't April 1st. My first reaction was, dude, I should totally go to a teacher and tell on him, but I decided to just run to the bathroom and hide in the stall, so.
I don't know, man. If I was you, I would have punched him in the face right on the spot.
I need to learn to not give in that easily. That's my problem.
No, giving in isn't your problem. Your problem is not getting payback. You should give in and then retaliate when he doesn't expect it.
So, what you're saying is that I should just punch him in the face when he doesn't expect it?
Yes.
No. You have to hit him where it hurts.
Oh.
Oh my gosh, no, not like that. You have to attack his reputation. Be sneaky.
Maybe.
Done.
I'm not giving in this time.
I never give in.
It's mine.
Star Wars theme with the Fritos here. You know, we're sitting here in the editing room, and it occurs to me these young people, these wonderful, creative young people that we have in our world today, they're our future, okay? And we all have stories to tell. These young kids had several stories to tell. And George, who was the writer of pretty much all of what you've seen today, he started with a blank piece of paper. That's where it all starts. And then it becomes magic. You take your story idea, you start putting it down on paper or in your computer, and it just kind of grows from there. But you know, as you're building your story, what you have to keep in mind is not just the fact that it's coming out of you to everyone else. You've got to make sure that they understand, that they follow the story, and that most of all, that they relate to that story. And you're telling your story and you want to touch them. in some way. Make them happy, make them sad, make them excited, just like everything in the latest Star Wars movies, actually just like everything in all the Star Wars movies. And you want them to not only appreciate that you're giving them this emotional feeling, whether it's good, bad, scared, excited, terrorized, you want them to remember it. You want them to remember you, just like in Star Wars movies, so you can't, they can't wait to see something else from you. So all of these great young people that you've met today at our Guilford High School, they've all got a great future ahead of them. It's going to be a lot of work, but you know what? They know what that means. They took a big part of their summer and made one, their movie. It may not be the best. You know, we all have this tendency to criticize things, especially as adults looking at what children have done. But you know what? I saw the magic. And that's what it's all about. I hope you enjoyed today's show. I got to get back to work, okay? Back to Star Wars, back to Doritos, and have some fun here. Ooh.
Good morning, I'm Declan, and I'll be your O.N.E. representative today. Now, can I ask your name?
Connor. Connor Wilson.
All right. Connor, before we start, do you have any questions? No questions. All right, let's begin then.
Chloe?
Oh, you must be Connor. Nice to meet you.
Yeah. Oh, these are for you.
Oh, thanks. I'll go put them down.
Okay. You know what? For the past 6 months, you've just become more and more controlling. You're suffocating me. Like, I just need you to trust me for once.
Excuse me? I'm sorry for being the only one who wants to maintain this relationship.
Madison.
Huh?
Oh, sorry, Liz. How long is it this time? Almost 8 minutes. That's a new record. So, why don't you do any of these things with your life partner?
He's a great guy and all, but
yeah?
We've grown apart. I feel as if he's just stopped trying.
I'm so sorry. I wasn't watching where I was going.
I was distracted too.
Wait, you're Madison, right? Madison Davenport?
Yeah.
I'm Connor Wilson. We used to go to school together in like sixth grade.
Open your eyes. I'm all.
I can't believe you just said that.